out to steal back life. Death will take its retribution elsewhere, balancing the scales. As above, so below. As above, so below. So below. As above, so below. So below.
Hachette Audio presents Kingdom of the Wicked, written by Kerri Maniscalco, read by Marisa Calin. For my grandmother, Vittoria Marie Nucci, and my aunt, Caroline Nucci, and for my great-grandparents, who immigrated from Shaka, Sicily to America, whose restaurant inspired much of this story. This may be a fantasy, but the love of family found within these words is very real. Flectere sine queo superos, aceronta movebo. If I cannot bend the will of heaven, I shall move hell. Virgil, Aeneid. Prologue. Outside, wind rattled the wooden chimes in warning. In the distance, waves crashed against the shore. The frantic whispers of water growing louder, as if the sea was a mage summoning violence. On this date, for nearly a decade now, the storm followed the same pattern. Next, thunder would roll in quicker than the tide, with lightning cracking electric whips across an unforgiving sky. The devil demanded retribution, a blood sacrifice for power stolen. It wasn't the first time he'd be cursed by witches, nor would it be the last. From her rocking chair near the fire, Nonna Maria monitored the twins while they chanted protection charms she'd taught them, a cornicello clutched tightly in each of their little fists. Pushing their howling gusts from her mind, she listened closely to the words Vittoria and Emilia whispered over the horn-shaped amulets, their matching dark heads bent in concentration.
By earth, moon, and stone, bless this hearth, bless this home.
It was the start of their eighth year, and Nonna tried not to worry over how quickly they were growing. She pulled her shawl closer, unable to ward off chills in the small kitchen. It had little to do with the temperature outside. As much as she tried to ignore it, sulfur snuck in through the cracks, along with the familiar plumeria and orange-scented breeze, raising the graying hair she'd swept up from her neck. Had she been alive, her own human grandmother would have called it an omen and spent the evening on her knees in the cathedral, rosary clutched close, praying to saints. The devil was on the prowl. Or one of his wicked brothers was. A sliver of worry slid in as quick and smooth as one of her paring knives, lodging itself near Nonna's heart. It had been an age since the last sighting of the Malvagi. Hardly anyone spoke of the wicked anymore, except in stories told to frighten children into staying in their beds at night. Now, adults laughed at the old folk tales, all but forgetting the seven ruling princes of hell. Nonna Maria never would. Their legends were burned into her mind, branding her with a bone-deep sense of dread. The area between her shoulders prickled, as if their midnight eyes were upon her, watching from the shadows. It was only a matter of time before they came looking, if they hadn't begun to already. One didn't steal from the devil and go unpunished. Her focus darted back to the twins. Like the churning Tyrrhenian sea, there was a restlessness about them tonight, one that spoke of unseen trouble to come. Vittoria's charms were rushed, and Emilia stumbled over hers, trying to keep up. A twig popped in the fire, quickly followed by another, the sound like wishbones snapping over their spellbooks, a warning in its own right. Nonna gripped the arms of her rocking chair, her knuckles turning the color of the blanched almonds lying on the counter.
Calmati. Not so fast, Vittoria, she scolded. You'll have to begin again if you don't do it correctly. Do you want to gather grave dirt alone in the dark?
Much to Nonna's dismay, Vittoria didn't appear as frightened as she should have. The thought of wandering around a graveyard under the light of a full moon and an angry storm seemed appealing to the child. She pursed her lips before offering a slight shake of her head. It was Emilia who answered, though, giving her sister a warning look.
We'll be more careful, Nonna.
To prove her point, Emilia held up the vial of holy water they'd gotten from the monastery and tipped it over their amulets, allowing one drop to sizzle over each. Silver and gold, an offering of balance between light and dark, a gift for what had been stolen all those years ago. As above, so below. Pacified, Nonna watched as they finished their charm, relieved when white sparks rose in the flames before burning red again. Another year, another victory. They tricked the devil once more. Eventually, there'd come a day when the charms wouldn't work, but Nonna refused to think of that now. She glanced at the windowsill, pleased by the dried orange slices laid out in even rows. Lavender sprigs hung to dry over the mantel, and the tiny stone island was covered with both flower and fragrant herbs waiting to be tied into neat bunches. Verbena, basil, oregano, parsley, and bay leaves. The scents mingled pleasantly. Some were for their celebratory dinner, and others for their charms. Now that the protection ritual was done, they might enjoy their meal. Nonna looked at the clock on the mantel. Her daughter and son-in-law would arrive from the family restaurant soon, bringing with them laughter and warmth. Storms and omens or not, all would be well in the DiCarlo home. The flames settled, and Emilia sat back, biting her nails. A nasty habit Nonna was determined to break. The child spit a nail clipping out and went to toss it on the floor.
Emilia! Nonna's voice rang loudly in the small room.
The child started, dropping her hand, and gave a sheepish look.
In the fire, you know better than to leave things for those who practice le arti oscure. Sorry, Nonna, Emilia mumbled.
She chewed her lip, then her grandmother waited for the question she knew was coming.
Will you tell us about the dark arts again? Or the malvagi?
Vittoria added, always interested in stories of the wicked. Even on nights they were forbidden from uttering such names.
Please?
We shouldn't speak of dark things aloud. It invites trouble.
They're just stories, Nonna,
Emilia said quietly.
If only that were true.
Nonna Maria traced a protection charm over her heart, finishing it with a kiss to her fingertips, and exhaled. The twins exchanged triumphant grins. It was impossible to keep the legends from the girls, no matter if it filled their heads with dreams of the seven princes of hell. Nonna feared they romanticized demons too much. It was best, she decided, to remind them why they should be wary of beautiful creatures without souls.
Wash your hands and help roll the dough. I'll talk while you make the buziate.
Their matching smiles warmed the chills still clinging to Nonna, brought on by the storm and its warning. The little corkscrew pasta served with tomato pesto was one of the girls' favorite dishes. They'd be pleased to find cassata already waiting in the icebox. Though the sweet ricotta sponge cake was an Easter specialty, the girls loved it on their birthday. Even with all of their precautions, Nonna was unsure how much sweetness would remain in their lives and spoiled them often. Not that she required extra incentive to do so. The grandmother's love was its own sort of powerful magic. Emilia pulled the mortar and pestle from the shelf, face strained in concentration as she gathered up the olive oil, garlic, almonds, basil, pecorino, and cherry tomatoes for the pesto alla trapanese. Vittoria removed the damp cloth from the mound of dough and began rolling the pasta as Nonna had taught her. 8 years old, and they already knew their way around the kitchen. It was unsurprising. Between their home and the restaurant, they practically grew up in one. They both peered up from thick lashes, their expressions identical masks of anticipation. Vittoria said impatiently, "Well, are you going to tell us a story?" Nonna sighed. "There are 7 demon princes, but only 4 the Carlos should fear. Wrath, greed, envy, and pride. One will crave your blood. One will capture your heart. One will steal your soul. And one will take your life."
"The wicked,"
Vittoria whispered, her tone almost reverent. "The Malvagi are demon princes who stalk the night, searching for souls to steal for their king, the devil. Their hunger ravenous and unyielding, until dawn chases them away." Nonna continued, slowly rocking in her chair. The wood creaked, covering the sound of the storm. She nodded toward their tasks, making sure they held up their end of the bargain. The girls settled into their work. "The 7 princes are so corrupted by sin that when they cross into our world..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.